What is to prevent, say, an uprising that can lead to revolution? And then in a fraction of time, the whole system collapses.
It must be a fragile system if it just
a few years. Yes, it is indeed.
Efficiency filter and heat exchange system.
Perspiration passes through the first layer and is gathered in the second, where salt is separated. Breathing and walking provide the pumping action.
To all the turbidium in the planet. Mars will go into global meltdown. That's why the aliens never turned it on.
I'm watching the TV's copy, Wholeness and Balance Vibration, everyone. And thank you for tuning in. Obviously, this is season 3 of AstroQuest, and I'm in the studio, and today I'm definitely dedicating things towards getting questions answered on the quest, because this is a major thing. When I actually did a show with a pre-recording of a show with Catherine Buckaloo from Truth Connections radio for 4.5 hours yesterday. And in that conversation is every bit of a massive upgrade. Because personally I'm looking at this stuff too, and I'm judging the quality of it, and I'm seeing, you know, how we can improve it. And it even has more information than the previous AstroQuest. And I also said personally that that's probably the longest running recording that I've seen that has such consistency to it, because it's 4 hours of just a massive put together of all the micro macro introspection that we've been doing. I will let everyone know today I'm a little under the weather. This is my second time being sick in 5 years, and it is self-inflicted. I actually, the season's been changing here. I guess there's some massive lineup going on. Sometimes I'm so busy, I obviously feel it in my innerverse, but I don't have time externally to see exactly what is going on. And so I went through a massive upgrade this week, and I remain balanced as much as possible. There wasn't really any what people call negative energy going on, but I definitely felt some transformations within my body. And I actually just busted a small blood vessel in my head, which is nothing major. I've actually done it at least 4 or 5 times when I was younger or at certain times in my life. So But because of that, you know, my demeanor is going to be somewhat, I don't know. I did it yesterday. This has been going on since Monday. So I did the 4 hours yesterday. And again, it was a great transmission. And I guess because of that, though, I did exert a great deal of energy. So I'm in here and I'm getting comfortable. And the reason is because what's most important, you know, just as I was talking to Kathy yesterday about, you know, when you get on this camera and you and even radio is a lot easier because you don't have to actually show yourself. And she said, yeah, you know, I wouldn't want to do video that much because, you know, you got to get yourself together and then you got to get out there and you got to present yourself. And obviously a lot of people in this line, they don't care about that. And that's great. And they like, just come as you are. You're going to come in your underwear if you want. You can just show up and give us the message. So that's always great. I feel great that we have people around us like that. But also the entire goal here for in one sector is to get this stuff to the point where the production in it is to the quality of what can go into normal media and an individual won't even be able to tell the difference from that moment when they start watching. Just to get past initial judgments. And this is obviously to be able to reach more people. I feel like that as a teacher, that's part of our way of being sure that we become teachers, making sure that our message does reach as many people or many audiences as possible. So I'm going to do a favor to myself and check sound just to make sure that everything is being recorded. Also, someone can let me know in the chat box if you can hear me loud and clear. That always does help because, excellent, Crystal, I do appreciate that. She's always crystal clear. So how do I want to begin this? Obviously, I'm going to do some calls, and people are even calling in now, and I'm definitely going to be looking up how we can get just a basic PBS system or a PBX system to route these phone calls and have a little whole thing going on and in a queue so that people, you know, won't get this just one at a time call, but I still can only take calls one at a time, and I do see the lines lighting up. You also see the number on the screen. I put a little lower third, as they call it, today, just so everyone has that number and just knows where they can call in to get us. I did want to start off with a few things, actually, before we get into questions, even though this conversation is primary questions, because by Monday, Tuesday, whenever that releases, Jason's doing the editing now, and whenever that recording releases, wow, like that is, that recording right there to me is that's it. That's for right now. I can't say it's going to be the best because we work to become better at what we do. And I guess that's the first part of the disclaimer. I do want to let everyone know the information that is being presented is to the best of our ability. It's what we've learned all the way up until this point. Functioning as a collective, and that collective frequency is accomplished when we just attain truth and be true to oneself, and then that locks you into a frequency of other individuals that are working on the same thing. It is an everyday thing. It's not something that you just do and then you have that status. Many people have done things in their lives that maybe they weren't trustworthy or someone wouldn't trust them at that moment, but as the past is the past, you can come right into the present and say, what are you saying now? Can I trust you with your message? And the reality of trust is that trust has a micro-macro connection or as above, so below connection. So if someone is explaining to you something that you need to determine whether or not if it's truth, you should be able to find that example of truth beyond what they're saying. You should be able to find it in, especially in nature, the mirror, and many other different places. So let me just take a quick drink of water. And again, I'm going to give you the disclaimer. And the disclaimer is that obviously, again, that we're giving you the information to the best of our ability. The other thing is that many of these conversations are so expansive. What happens is some individuals start getting emotional and feeling even negative and conflicted about the entire situation, and this blocks their learning. And I'll just explain it very simple. When you were younger, what gave you so much energy, I'm going to take a look at that in a minute, what gave you so much energy was that you had the ability to keep growing. Everything was new. Everything that you approached, you were like, oh my goodness, I'm this and I want to learn this. And you see the baby do it. It's so funny because they're just like grabbing everything, pushing everything. And then, you know, you get a little bit older and then you start becoming rigid. And now you're not willing to learn everything and take, you know, everything and experiment with everything too much because of supposedly these lessons that you've learned. And then, of course, if the person even reaches elderly age, it depends on, you know, the state of mind and the state of being. But there's even less conforming. There's even less flexibility. The being is unwilling to change, unwilling to learn, okay? And so that's the whole process of the growth to the decay. And the reason why I keep growing personally is because I keep making myself available to my childlike state of mind of understanding that I have a lot of things to learn, because I didn't come here speaking English. I didn't come here knowing geometry. These are all things that I learned, and it allows me to communicate with you, and it allows me to understand this world and what's going on in this world a lot better. I actually don't need this right now. You know, that does give me some kind of comfort. So the reality here is that it's very, very important for us to realize, just for yourself, within your own nucleus, watch your own mind. Forget everyone else's thing going on. Like, you know, I remember a wise man said, it amazes me how much people think about things that they cannot change, but yet things that they can, they give no thought to. And this is a real thing, because if we're always going out, this person, I want to talk to them, I want to speak to them, I want to go to them, I want to do this, I want to... If there's anything you should have learned on the quest in this last 4 years, is that's the wrong direction. It's understand. You could be right there. It's about examining even the most simple things that you've already found out, but to see if you haven't deep core drilled it for its true meaning. Because obviously, when we're at a certain level of our consciousness, everything that we're saying that we're becoming aware of, or that we're interacting with, we're only interacting to a certain percentage, if you may, a certain level of division, if you may, because we are yet to get into the fully perfected stage. That's something that we're working towards. And then at the same time, to insist that one is already in the fully perfected stage is only to shortchange oneself, because truly, if you think this is fully perfected, wait until you see the next level of this. So, the disclaimer. So the disclaimer is about, once you hear some of this stuff and it's time for you to take your bitter medicine, just like I have to take mine, if you are ready to eject from the cadman, which is what I'm showing you here, it's actually a male-female. When you're ready to eject, you take the center pipe and you blast out the top all the way, you see, to, I guess that would be your left. You blast out at the top, and then you leave this body, because this is the most current diagram to the program physical world as on its illusionary informational level, meaning that look at nature as being the firmware. It was always here. It was holding up the frequency. The seeds have already been buried even under the lava. That's going to be going on. But when mankind comes in this history and all of these kind of things, at that point is time, this history and all of these kind of things, at that point is time, a body, at that point a body is constructed. And this is that body. And this body obviously is so intricate. I've actually posted this on the website for those who wanted to take a closer look. You'll find it in the blogs a little bit further down. It may not be on the first page, but just check the archive. But it's so intricate and so interwoven, it always fascinates a person even to see the chart the first time. They're like, I got to get that. Where is that? I want that. And this is very synonymous with the same reaction that people have with the stories and the mysticism and all the different variations that have gone on after the Big Bang, or after the big sexual relationship with our reality and its opposing force or its shadow, thus creating, which is what we actually do. We take positive and negative and we put them together, male and female, and then we create. And the birth from that is a combination of what comes behind that, aka the drama. Because the intention of the drama is it's a long saga, legends, empires, all these kind of things, and then many different intricate points that would take aeons to explain, especially in English. I'm using light codes, and maybe I can get it to you in a couple minutes, or what you call minutes. So the reality is that after you've heard something that may not be getting you into the right mood, realize that a big part of our message also contains the keys to unlocking the body to get you to the point to where all of this stuff just passes right through you. This information is for a certain kind of individual that needs to handle all the what's, when's, why's, where's, and how's. The wonderland, basically, of the wilderness of the mind, meaning that they need to get all the questions answered, because the mind, who is actually connected to the hive. The hive mind is asking these questions because it doesn't know these questions. Someone adjacent to you is in their mind, why am I here? What is this about? This is crazy. I'm tired. And they're sending that into a hive. And this hive works on cymatics. It works on the cymatics of our phi base geometry of our body, two arms, two legs, and a head, et cetera, in most cases. But just even the bone structure and the organs and all these things in our bodies place us into a specific group of, and that's why we call ourselves human beings. That's called a hive. So all the collective mind states, thoughts, histories, biorhythms, records, all deeds, all these different things are all in one organic thing that they like to call the astral, the astral records, okay? And so it's important to realize also that's how reincarnation works, is that the data of you is already in that database. So when you leave this shell, when you're floating around, you're still in touch with the data. The data is still there. And then incarnation process takes again as you're going through the light, and then bam, you're back here again. So what I wanted to say then in the disclaimer is that just remember that you are not the body, meaning that this was designed as a quest here for this particular reality. It is a template, a blueprint. There are many more of these in these kind of realities. And then even the more fascinating thing is that there's dimensions that do not function on these kind of things at all. They are boundless. I mean, there's no bindings, no actual geometry, because there's nothing to measure. So just realize that. So if it gets too deep and too crazy for you, pull the ejector. So in saying that, I guess it's about time for us to get ready to take off. Let me take another drink here. Wow, I think I just covered pretty much everything that I need to say, except for one more thing. I was doing some research about 3 days ago, and man, I think I was actually researching something entirely about something else, and then I was also watching a movie simultaneously that was about genetic engineering and things, and they started to call off the different elements that they need it in order to either create excessive feeling or decrease feeling altogether, and it was dopamine. And that dopamine is naturally produced by the body. Is dope. I mean, it tells you in the word. It's naturally produced by the body. And I went to Wikipedia really fast, and I just went right in to look at this, the molecular structure of this element, and to understand a little bit more about it. And I realized that right away, and you can read the Wikipedia article yourself, that dopamine is actually connected to melanin, that there's a symbiotic relationship between the two, which will probably explain why many melanin-dominant individuals have an inclination towards stimulants. But that was as much for a moment that I was able to grab on just that regular physical interfacing level. And then I was immediately thrusted off into this higher state of consciousness about what goes on when your parents utilize a lot of dopamine from their time, and this of course is the 60s, the 70s, etc. Our parents utilizing a lot of these substances that contain not only this substance but many more, but I'm giving you just a core example. Because what happens is that obviously from your mother and your father, you are the upgraded version, but you are still them and more. That's the truth. You know, you can't, no matter how much you like your mother or father or whatever, you won't be able to run away from this one, okay? So if the mother has been and father have been utilizing these kind of substances, what they're really doing when they need to go and get it is they're sending these messages into the future saying, I need more dopamine. I need more dopamine. So then what happens is when the child comes out, the child actually is producing more dopamine. And that's called ADD. Look at it. They say ADD is the excessive production of dopamine. So this means, to connect in with what I was explaining before about how all the organs, chakras, are actually producing endorphins and basically high-end drugs and keeping the body somewhat doped up in an illusion, melanin, serotonin, all these different ends, okay? So, or nines, I like to call them. So this is about energies. This is about where these energies really reside. And so then I started thinking, because that was like, okay, so I got the hard-coded data. Sometimes the mind needs that, especially if it's in somewhat more of a logical left-brain logical spectrum. And then as you begin to make your glide over to the spiritual side of yourself, you start thinking, man, this is, especially as for a person like me, because I do give a spiritual message, and I feel that it's very potent and pertinent to the world. And so I said, man, you know, this means that I even have to push even stronger now. If I'm willing, and I'm willing to stay here with our children and be the last one that closes the door for this aeon and segment of people who are here, to get ready to bring so much of a hybridized message to the one that is being introduced now as the current spiritual template, meaning religion. And the reason is because there is so much action that a person with dopamine needs to be doing in order to stay, keep constructive with that kind of energy. It is opposed to the bowing down and the sitting around of all of the ancient, or so-called ancient, because they don't seem so ancient to me, religions of these days. It's bowing down, everyone's tired, the being is giving no energy, appears it's sucking the energy. And then the person is always asking and begging. No one's in a point of being able to offer something massive and major, except for the people who are in charge of the whole thing. So you see, those whole kind of dynamics don't work for ADD. And since we have millions of kids now, millions that are like this, and adults too, I've seen some, I'm ready to go in full-fledged with a design of a brand new way of looking at our mental, spiritual, and physical dynamic that will make the levels of dopamine coming into the system all over the world now, especially with, I mean, this is, the world's issue is drugs or dragons. DRG is a dragon. Drugs are dragons. So trying to ride the dragons of energy, people are falling off. They can't tame these dragons. So what happens is that we have to put people in a more upgraded perspective so that they realize that they can produce, when they come into the full stage of their alchemical transmutation and marriage, can produce a substance that can't be found anywhere externally and suffices to do everything internally, aka the panacea. So that will give you just a little bit of what kind of was discussed on that 4-hour conversation that I had with Catherine. And in addition to that, obviously, we'll have some questions here. So much of some new stuff will start coming out, like how I discovered the timelines of this planetary system within other beings that reside here now are based on the times of other planetary systems, which is information that is readily available to you, that you can actually go and see how long is a year. Like, for instance, I believe on Venus, it's 243 Earth days a year, but there was an anomaly here. Let me see. Okay, that's it. Each day on Venus takes 243 Earth days. You just got to think about that. Like, one of our days, or one of their days, excuse me, is 243 of our days. Then you start calculating. And then my wife asked me the other day, she said, how long do you think some of these entities live? And I said, you know, I kind of drew a blank for a minute, but then was brought back to this for the simple calculations, just to get an idea, because it is one big clock. So if I would probably times the number by 72, because that's the average rate of life. And that is also a very entwined number with the whole time system of the Jehovian Saturnalian fields. So I would say that you would take, let's say with Venus, 243 times, excuse me, you would take 243 times 72, and then maybe you would get the time span of Venusian spirit. Now, the reason why I say a spirit, because I'm starting to realize this whole process of different life forms or different changes in your being is because of still being separate from the soul. meaning soul, meaning one, no such thing as souls, but that spirits who are basically still graduated forms, because they've gone through a couple of universities or universes, are still divided from the soul, trying to either find their way back, or actually even most cases still finding their way back, even though they may think they're going in the wrong direction. It's a very strange thing when you get into these fields and you start seeing, again, the progress of a spirit on its way back to being a soul. And the state of mind and the state of conscience one needs to be in to really do that. Like, some people are already limited to something they can accomplish here on Earth. Like, oh, 20 years on Earth, if I wanted to go to Tibet, I'm sure I'd be enlightened. I guess your mind is telling you that. And here's the thing about the mind, and this is why in this dimension they love to make everyone think that the mind is more superior, because it is far inferior. And let me show you why. With the mind, you can think about going somewhere. I'm going to go to the store. Do I got enough money? What am I going to go buy? Let me get a list together. You know, the person's going to go through all of that, right? So here's the thing, though. The mind will never be able to tell if the person got a pop tire, if the person had five red lights, there was an ambulance. There's going to be tons of things that the mind cannot even think about, because unless the experience begins, none of those things become a person being becomes aware of. Showing that the, let me say this right, because I'm being distracted a little bit over here by the phone calls, but let me just also take a look here and make sure everything's going on wrong. I mean, going on right. Nothing's going on wrong. Okay, great. So that's what we're talking about, is that the reason why action is so powerful is because you get a chance to really see the steps that are entwined in the action, okay? And the dimension, then, this particular plane, goes into this whole mind thing. They get everyone into the mind. Oh, we're going to give them these titles. We're going to give them this knowledge and about this, you know, chemistries and all these different things. But it doesn't matter, because the compartmentalization is, they will never try to do this at their home. They'll only try to do it in the compartment or department that they're in. And the reason why is because they'll be so inundated with tasks and duties, because there's always tasks and duties within those jobs. Like, they be working on stuff, they bring it home. They start working on it then. Much of the research is the collective idea about what would be best for the company. Like, oh, I think we should work on this drug that heals the heart. And that'll be probably best for our pharmaceutical company. But it's going to have to be FDA, WHO-DA, this DA approved. And so thus, we're going to have to use these kind of substances, these kind of substances. And on top of that, we need to obtain a patent. So we're going to need to mix a couple substances that are really experimental just to get our patent. And then here's the other side of the selfishness and stinginess with this patent situation. A person that may not have the capital and the means to actually create the idea will still have the mental idea and be able to write out the schematics and fill out the forms and things that are necessary to find the patent, submit the patent, okay, and then can't build the item. So then when someone else comes that has this brilliant idea of emancipating multiple species and introducing perpetual energy and all this kind of stuff, they say, oh, sir, sorry, sir, there's a patent on this already, and if you try to do this, you can be sued. Like, you will be sued. Okay, so then they turn around and go to China or Japan and give them the patent. And because that's just out of our jurisdiction, they can develop your design and whatever you're doing right over there and then bring it back over here, and then you have no way of doing anything, not to mention all the real intelligent designs, which I even pulled up a couple. I can show them on the internet even today. Going through the patent offices, all the real intelligent designs are sitting there in high res, just there, not being developed. And on top of that, these major organizations, also third party or ultra wealthy billionaires, the Monaco types, have these kind of things sitting in their house and utilizing them, continuously regenerating their bodies for the physical dimension, as I'll get into later about the term, I'd rather reign in hell than serve in heaven. You know, that's a deeper stage of consciousness within the malevolent forces. So here we go. Let's go ahead and get right into taking these questions because the phone line may bust. But there's a question here that says, pot a stimulant? Pot is known as a depressant in most cases, but it does produce tetrahydrocannabinols for dragons. Tetrahydras. I mean, what do you want to say? How does he know all of this? How is it true? And it's because, like, it's all really labeled. You just have to know what you're looking at, and then you have to uninstall compartmentalizations, because what compartmentalization will do is look at the Wikipedia entry, and this is what I realized that compartmentalization will do, because some people will come back and they'll try to debunk you, right? And they'll say Wikipedia actually said that melanin and melanite are not related. Let me show you this. Okay. And I wish I was on my other computer here because I can just show you the screen. In fact, I think that that's something that we have to keep incorporated all the time. It's just that extra computer. But you can kind of see it here from my computer. And all right, I'll know how to wire this place up next week. That's okay. I'll know how to do it next week. So that way I have a computer. I can show you right what's going on. But you can go yourself, Wikipedia, dopamine. And these people have the nerve to say, and let me just get to it here. Maybe they even erased it. I remember one time they had went into erasing stuff. Hold on real quick. I'll find it another way. There's always another way. I'm glad that we're not on one of those networks that are like, oh my goodness, we got to take our time. We got to go. Okay, here we go. Okay, so this dopamine basically is key in producing melanin. Okay, so they're basically married to each other. And there's another dopamine called melanin dopamine. And this actually article may even be increased because it looks quite longer than it was even when I looked in here. But the reality is that it was hilarious, the compartmentalization within this article, when they attempted to say that this melanin and melanite doesn't have anything to do with melanin. Everything has to do with itself, meaning that everything is everything. So even the statement itself right off the bat is false. But this is how you know when falsehood is being introduced, because division is always introduced. So this is the thing. Like, it was a deeper level. And you can go through this article yourself. It's quite long. But it shows just how so many of these substances that our body is producing are so intertwined with one another that it's all a chemical war. If it wants you to be happy, you can put it in the food, you'd be happy. If it wants to be smart but still not cracking through, put in the food, smart, not cracking through. And only the beings that have already tapped into their inner selves to seen the reflection of perfection, like the core, like not who you are on the outside after thousands of years of being weathered of going through phi, but the core of who you are. And then that's going to actually get you to the, like I said, the perfect reflection. Okay, and then we'll call that today for this show, the perfect reflection. Okay, and what that's about is that's about the knowledge that once you see the perfected molecule, perfected DNA, etc., that the way that our body works, and this is connected into the 100 monkey syndrome and all this kind of stuff, is it will mirror it. Because once it sees perfection again, it will just go for that. Because that's how we work. It's like if someone sees something better, even in this world, they have a tendency to go for that, right? Especially if they know they have a chance. So in the universe, it's the same thing. Once we see the perfected DNA, we drop the DNA and go into a whole nother DNA string. That's the ability of being a human versus in the old reptilian state of mind, holding up the first strain of DNA, just which is the foundation of the Saturnalian black pillar, rather reign in hell than serve in heaven kind of thing going on, all right? So here we go. We're going to go ahead and get started. I'm going to start by taking calls. Okay, first protocols here, because it's very important, because I will hang up on you today. I'm serious. I mean, I think sometimes people think that I'm just this really nice furry creature, namaste, and it's not always about that. You know, you could do that sometimes, but sometimes it's time to actually really be in order and to enforce. So today, I really don't want to hear any comments, because I want to get through a lot of questions. So if you're calling in, you're saying all this and all and my thing and what I've done and all that, it's not the time for that. So I'm going to promptly dismiss you. I may just even hang up, because, you know, in all reality, I don't have the time for it today. And the next thing is that you will have two questions. As I wrote in the protocols, it'd be best if you had written those questions down, and also condense them for understanding, meaning like see what you really want to know in the questions. Some people, they don't actually ask questions. They're actually saying a statement. And so just understand the difference between a question and a statement. If you can put a question mark behind it, then it's a question. So if you have a question, that's what we're answering today. And it seems remedial, everyone, but realistically, it's important that this is explained, because sometimes just weird stuff starts happening with people these days. Let's see. I also said here, if you can, and that's, I guess, the final thing, is just mute your line on the actual live stream. And that's important, because it gives us this double feedback reverb thing, that because you're actually calling in on the line that the studio's audio is hooked into. So without further ado, we'll go ahead and begin. Let me get a little bit of water here, and let me check time. All right, so we're 37 minutes in. We're going to go ahead and take a break at the top of the hour. Okay, let's go with area code 401. And I'm going to have to test sound real quick, everyone, so just give me a moment. And also, I'm going to need this now. All right, wholeness, area code 401. You're on Astral Quest Season 3.
Hi, how are you, Savan?
Oh, I'm doing pretty good. Thank you for
asking. My question to you is, like, sometimes the world seems so fake to me, because everything I think, speak, and dream pops up into my reality. Like, I can literally track it. And it's good, because I get to live, like, a nostalgic life, but I go through these upgrading scenarios where I learn, and then I boost up to a higher frequency. I'm sorry, I'm out of breath. So what I'm noticing is that I've gotten to a new level, but everything seems to disappear from my memory. Like, all my twos are gone, my intuition, my sense of feeling objects and people. And I kind of dedicate myself to my yoga practices, my meditation, my churning. And I've done my due diligence in terms of changing my diet. But it's like some people come into my life, and I have no control over them coming into my orbit. But I notice that before they come and after they come, they seem to leave some residue with me. And I don't know how to shift this. I've done cleansing. I've done a couple of things, but I don't really know what it is. I know that life is a projection of me as well, so I try to work on the things that come through. But I kind of don't want to spend my whole life having to, you know, search for a way out to some extent.
Okay. Well, let's just get the attachment situation solved. Really, just from a very, very direct level, just meaning what people do leave with you after you interact with them. We have to realize that we're in this collective build together. And so what happens is that, let's say, for instance, I create something, or I recreate it, because, you know, you have to really get really far up there to start creating things. But if I recreate something, right, and then you use it, and let's just say, for instance, it's a stove, and I create this stove, and then someone else creates this flower, and then they put the flour in the stove, and then now we got cake. And so what happens is that cake is this marriage between my idea and your idea. And the reason why I wanted to explain it very loosely like that is because obviously there's even more intricate connections that people have together. And these connections are, you know, they leave a lot of the person's energy, and because there's already basically children made.
Absolutely.
And this happens, this is not even a sexual thing in the sense where a male to a female or female to a male. This happens with any organism that we actually interact with. So what happens then is that you get these kids running around, And this is, again, the easiest way to explain it, and the correct term is kids. And so you get these beings that are running around that have a biorhythmic connection to you on some level or another. But all they're looking for really is that perfected mirror. And that's kind of what we were talking about before, that what you'll witness then is you'll witness as you continue to expand into your, as you said, you don't really want to go through these multiple lives of continuously doing this. That actually shows the indication of the being fully aware of their path, this particular path, and that gives the ability to actually change the path. So this all runs simultaneously with you actually cracking, in a tense, if you want to use that term, for yourself, exactly how to escape, in a tense, this particular shell. And because then your work is done, your work is complete, you've tilled the garden, et cetera. And so that's the advice that I can actually render on that particular situation. And do let me know if I didn't directly answer the question.
You did a little bit, but I guess what I'm saying is that, like, if I'm creating from a hot space, everything seems to be balanced. But I'm not sure. It just seems like when people come into contact with me, I then see them. It's like they become my doppelganger. It's like I'm seeing them with my energy, and I'm feeling their energy with me.
Right. Well, again, I can't say it enough about the mirroring effect. But if you notice how that's why I was saying in a hive, the more dominant mind wins. Okay. So what happens is that if you are giving an awful lot of energy, you'll see this very synonymous with the sun. Remember, because the sun is neither male nor female. It's actually both. So when when a person has achieved this stage within, the only thing that the other beings that are around you are seeing is like a sun or a source of light. And then because they want to be like that, they attempt to emulate it. So then
so it's really a compliment to some extent.
Oh, well, it's always a compliment initially, but of course, sometimes it could be, it depends on your character, because those who have somewhat of a, if they can exhibit the trait of jealousy, have a tendency not to like people to emulate what they're doing and feel, to a certain extent, invaded. Like,
sure,
okay, why are
sure.
they doing that? That's mine, or why they use it.
Well,
mine.
I guess for me, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, go
ahead. I guess for me, sometimes it feels like I can't find my home base anymore. You know, I'm like searching for my home base. Like sometimes if the energy is too strong, or maybe, I don't know, maybe it's my, I'm just not sure what it is, but I do notice that, like, I can't go back to my, not that I can't go back, I shouldn't even use that term, but I have a hard time centering myself back into my home base where all my tools are just there for me. Like sometimes I literally begin to forget how to breathe again. It's like I start from the bottom again. It's really interesting.
Yeah, I mean, this also is, you know, you'll see why monks stayed in caves, but this is also sometimes the effect of being in a lot of life paths and life streams when you're on the highway of life. In a certain tense, you're a hot spot. I mean, I don't know where you're living at and how many people are around you, but it sounds like that you can be contacted and gotten in touch with rather easy. Right. And so that's the thing, is that sometimes many individuals choose to firewall themselves to a certain degree in order for them to, because you got to realize that in climbing the ladder, you can go up, and let's say as a diagram, let's say you're going up this high and then end up coming back down here and then going up, you know, and then coming back down here.
That's what I do. I go up and come down, and I go up and I bring people with me. Like, I get that part of it. But I guess what I'm trying to do, you said a key word, is firewall myself. To protect myself from being anchored. Like this time I feel like I came down and I'm having a hard time getting back up.
Right. Indeed. I mean, this is something that I guess not too many people talk about or talk about the methods of in which how to do it, but I think it's just the knowledge of it. But we are getting into a period now because of the energetic forces of the planet, meaning that everyone's energy is increasing, but this doesn't necessarily mean that everyone is on the same path of energy that you
Absolutely.
Are.
Absolutely.
Right. So as they're
Absolutely.
Getting stronger, that actually functions like two devices that are attempting to use the same bandwidth or frequency, and then one device is in a tense overriding the other. And so this is where you do need that firewall. Now remember, the height of this is one can actually achieve that in the center of New York. Okay, so that would be the most extreme, meaning the person who has the most control over their mind, body, and soul, which is tied into their emotions, right? They can be in the middle of New York City and it's not even bothering them. They don't actually have a ground there, meaning that it takes them to really go deep. When you see the energy coming from the bottom of the feet, to go deep to actually touch what we know as an energetic earth ground, right? Because you can imagine New York sewers and all this kind of stuff. So as you're going down into this, you're trying to ground in, into the place, there's nothing to ground into but filth, okay? So but the person who is very strong has a root that can even go through the filth and then go all the way down to where the minerals and nutrients are that they need. So this is why I mentioned that.
So maybe when I'm grounding myself, I'm not going in as deep as I should be going.
Man, I had
meditated. Is that what you're saying?
I meditated with a guy that when I took my feet off the ground, he went nuts. And he said, man, before I can even start to meditate with you, the first thing we need to start working on is just you keeping your feet on the ground. Because in the strictest sex, they can feel their grounding in a plane. That's how, it's like a tentacle, and it just buries itself in it, because what it's doing is it's getting to the nutrients that's needed. Because what is the effect? Like, look exactly what you're saying. The effect then of this situation is that you feel like you actually don't have enough energy to keep climbing the ladder, so you come back down and start all
Absolutely.
Over.
I literally feel attacked. Sometimes I can't even feel my head because it feels like, you know, I'm vibrating at a high frequency. I can feel the energy going through my spine, and my head becomes so sensitive. And I sometimes feel attacked because it's like I feel like they literally have access to me without even being here.
Exactly.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, that makes perfect sense because, again, as the body becomes more sensitive, that's what they call it. That's why.
That's exactly what I'm saying, Saban. It's like I'm becoming too sensitive.
Right, but this is, again, like I was explaining with the ground. So then let's just see the whole metaphor, because I feel like we're answering a question that a lot of people really need to know the answers to.
Okay.
Now, what I was explaining before is on this show that's about to come out, is that many of what we would really know as masters, not self-proclaimed masters and teachers, when they met you, the first thing they would do is gauge your situation and then gauge if they had enough gong to assist you with the situation. And what gong is literally, we can use that. That's the term for that energy that's getting either pulled or replenished. Okay.
So
they didn't play in the tense of if they knew they didn't have enough gong to assist you, they wouldn't even talk to you, because they know that with every action, there's a reaction. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So now when you interact with someone, especially when you're already trying to get yourself back together per se, the last thing you want to do when you run into another person, say, hey, look, can you help me, blah, blah, blah. And then you think, oh, I got enough. I got still more than them. They can come and stay with me. You're basically, you didn't gauge your gong right. Cause after all, you need to get to a stage where you can generate this almost unlimited, and we're both still working to get there, right? So this is the thing, is that it's the weights and measures that are being used. And we talked about this before, about the ill distribution of the goods that are committed to your charge. And not to make that sound complex, but it's basically with your current, your currency, your energy, your seeds, your ideas. Where you're planting them is what you're going to be eating later on, literally. When you get to the stage of 8, you will actually have to eat that. So if you planted it in grounds and in fertilization, because you know that's where the grounding was in, is in those individuals in particular. If you planted it on that soil, then you're going to eat the food back from that. And this is what's actually going on the spiritual level. So I'm sure that
that's so interesting, because my guides have been telling me to reserve my energy only for those who match my energy. Don't go out giving your energy to people who are just on a different level than you. Just hold that space and build yourself up. And when people are in alignment, if it needs to be shared, then you share it.
Right.
What I'm doing is planting the seed in the wrong gardens.
For sure. And then especially, you know, when you're still tapping into the perpetual energy yourself, because here's the thing, because a lot of this ties into healing. And again, like I've been really in counsel with some massive stages of intellect. So they just give it to you how it is. You just feel like you got to go home and start over after. But the reality is that there's a difference between giving someone the tools to help themselves versus helping them. Okay. And let me explain this, because if someone is sick and you have this, you know, electricity, that's the first level of the powers, is you have this light electricity and sensation coming from the hands, put your hands on the individual and the individual recovers because you just transferred gong to them. Now, this is what happens. Their actual ailment is directly tied into their karma. It just is, whether you can see that far or not. So what you've done is you've prolonged, and I'm not saying you personally, but the individual that has used this method, has prolonged the person's karma. So two things happen here, and neither party benefit. Whatever the person was to learn behind the karma, they will not learn at that moment. And then the gong that you have transferred to cure the karma actually puts you into this contract to a certain degree, like a certain spiritual contract that has to run its course. And so this is the kind of thing they were talking about. Well, look, if you want to be an adept, meaning which all this knowledge was tied to before it became like just on the internet everywhere, then these are the rules you need to know, because you, after all, don't want to open up channels that you'll later on have to close. And this is exactly how they explain it. They say that when you start path, let's say, for instance, Christianity, and I can be one of the people in this sector then, that because I started in the path of Islam and I went to Christianity. But when you start a path, it actually opens a gland, because that's what a path really is. Inside of the body, it is actually an area or a tube that hasn't been really traveled down before, to a gland, which is basically an energy center. And so when you open up that gland, you start to travel down it. Now, what happens if you get a quarter of a way and you realize that either you don't want to go down this path or you want to try a new path? So then you go back and that gland is still open. You try another path. When you open up that path, because all these paths take energy to accomplish and to go down, okay, you have to actually close that path before there's enough energy to fully go through that path. And this is the as below explanation of what happens when a person opens up too many paths at one time. And then
how do you close it?
You close the path by grounding yourself. And this is everything to do with grounding. Grounding yourself first means a reboot in a certain tense. The person actually gets to a stage where they say, okay, it's just, generally, most of the time this happens with some type of breakdown or some kind of spiritual upheaval, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then they separate themselves, you know, or isolate themselves as much as possible. They cut down anything that's pointing into you, anything that's inputting. This means books. This means TV. This means anything that is giving you input. They cut down on the input in order to get grounded so that they can actually hear themselves again. Then the cultivation starts, okay? Because remember, what this energy is tied directly into is the term known as cultivation. Cultivation is just like what you see as you cultivate something here in the physical reality. It takes a period of time to get the right level of consistencies within the cultivation for there to be growth. So when you have to keep starting all over again, your cultivation or your petri dish, your custom, etc., just goes out the door again, and you have to start with the new petri dish again, right? So the cultivation is the key to increasing your level of mineralization within your body. And this cultivation is first activated when some stage of solace is going on, and where you can actually center yourself and figure out what you really should be doing and what you really are tied into, right? Because all the chatter is gone. And then that's when you embark, and just like everyone else from the beginning of that stage again, you're fine with this rebirth. You embark from that stage, but this time knowing much more exactly about the energetic dynamics of what's really happening with your interaction with others.
Sure, sure.
And on top of that, I will give you one last pointer here. And this pointer will be the last thing I'll say, and then I'll get on to the next calls. All of this may sound very complex, but it boils down to two things. People either build or destroy. So when you come across a destroyer, especially if you don't have the gong to assist them, then you tell them two words. If you have to say anything and they're pressuring you, you're lost. Serious.
You're lost.
You're lost. Because what happens is that, like, some people think that that's rude, but serious, if you're talking to someone and they're going into deep levels of division with you and they're trying to go back at it and they want you to keep saying something, watch what happens when you say you're lost. Because then don't say anything else.
Well, then you take back your power in doing that.
Say that again.
You take back your power in doing that.
Well,
there's no more of that experience. There don't have to be a bridge.
Exactly. Well, the valve is closed. Like,
because
what happens is that we leave all these valves open. And this is also, you know, it gets into something else. And like I said, I don't have a problem with taking a little time on these questions when they're this powerful and introspective, because what I already cracked into also is the major chakra that never develops in the children in the Western Hemisphere, because that's basically what you're dealing with, children. If you go overseas into the East and you see men, the entire geometry and the structure is totally different, especially deep levels of spiritual men. You take a man from the West Coast and then put him next to a deep meditative man from the East Coast, they don't actually even look the same. The amount of energy radiating
from
one is totally different, right? So we're talking about the children in the West Coast, okay? And so what happens is that the child has not developed a throat chakra, right? The most of the people in the United States, probably about 90% of them, have an underdeveloped throat chakra. And this, you know, included me. Like, I'm still fixing my throat chakra. This is helping doing these shows for the last 4 years. But what the defunct throat chakra is connected to is demos, or democracy. Because the democracy is set up that even if you know what you need to say, if it's not really correct to say it, democracy wins, you don't say it. So this leads to a lifetime, or years and years and years of basically putting the gloves on and tissue all over the hands every time we have to deal with someone. So this creates a blocked throat chakra, because what happens is, first of all, time is wasted, because if you tell someone something directly, especially the first time they do it, like when a person first slips out of line, you have to be tightened down throat chakra, full open throat chakra, is going to tell you right then, hey, that you can't do that. That's not something that I even agreed to. Hey, there's billions of people here in this world. You can go be with all of them. There's even more websites. You can go hang out on all of those. But for me personally, in my space and my frequency, for what I'm working on, I can't even get into
Absolutely. That's what I'm learning right now too, is cutting towards. I mean, you're so accurate right now. It's so divine. I love it. And I'm grateful to have this opportunity to actually talk to you. Well, by any chance, do you do one-on-one coaching sessions?
Not right now, only because that would end up tying me up even more crazier. This is really what I'm going to work with more, is just getting probably another day out of the week that's just designated towards questions, and also putting a specific area in the site where people can ask those questions, because it's only going to help everyone else. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to install a system that's very similar to Reddit, and then it actually rates, because we want to get, this is open source spirituality, so we want other people to get involved too. And a lot of people have a great deal of insight, especially once they get some of these catalysts and sparks of knowledge to connect with what they already know. So what we're going to have is a system that bumps up those answers that are more like what a person, basically it's voted up, so it's going to be the best answer for the question. And I think that that's ingenious in itself, because we have this situation right now with just a person come in there and they may be high and drunk. Like, people like to just get drunk and high and listen to this kind of stuff sometimes. Sometimes they actually just need to get in that mood to listen to it, right? So then they go into the blog.
Well, that's their power for extension, yeah.
Right, and then, exactly. And then they go into the blog, though, and then they type in something crazy, and that becomes you. But you may be over there serious trying to figure out how to, you know, and his answer is bumping down. They call that trolls, but his answer is bumping down the real answer to the source. So that's how we can fix that, so. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, my name is Raina Savan, and I totally appreciate your time.
Okay, Raina, thank you for calling in, and it's been awesome.
Okay. Indeed. You take care.
Okay, wholeness. All right, so we're going to catch this call from 646, who's actually was calling in before we even started. I'm trying to get on this line. Let me move my mouse here real quick and check time. Okay, so we're going to take this call, and then we're going to go to a break. But obviously, very good question. I really do appreciate her calling in and getting that clarity, because, as I said, there's a lot of stuff that I've just come into. And it's every time, because we were saying this, I guess, maybe 4 years ago, we were just saying it in another kind of way. And I just really want to tell people this. It's also about, because when you understand this entire cycle of Ouroboros, right, beginning married to the end, and them both not agreeing, positive and negative, you realize that your success is imminent. You'll succeed. Like, no, I can't hold you back. Somebody else can't hold you back. It's just not even possible, okay? But there is a question. How long is it going to take? How long is it going to take for you to succeed? Because, see, that's the questions that I'm asking myself. I'm saying, you know, looks like you're onto something. Yeah, probably 10 years, you may be able to even disappear, walk through walls and stuff. But is it going to really take you 10 years? Like, can you cut down the time? Because that's where the next stage of the consciousness has to leap to. It doesn't just stand still like, okay, well, shoot, as long as I keep eating these goji berries and stay away from the meat and keep breathing and do these cleansings, I'll be straight, right? I don't know, because eventually all that probably would get very boring, and then you were going to need to do something else. And so that's the big part of action, because, like, right now I want to launch this project. I was thinking about it yesterday. There's these devices. They pull rainwater or humidity out of the air into the device and then distills it, right, to get rid of all the bacteria, and then sends it through a mineralization filter and then pushes the water back out, right? And this device is 50K. And in villages, they have water and there's good humidity in the areas, which is one of the requirements, but because the water is still, it's contaminated. So thus, all the people that are there are sick and have diseases because they can't even get fresh water. So you launch a campaign, you buy four of these machines, you start dropping them in Costa Rica, Africa, and different places where people, they're so far out of this back and forth going on with the elves and the angels, because that's the other thing I was talking about in the four-hour recording, that there's a war going on here, back and forth, between the dark angels or dark elves and the light elves. And that actual war is hidden within the symbol of the seven-pointed star. Because if you notice, when you draw the Crawlian star from what it really is in the book that he explains it, it's an upside-down seven-pointed star. And then you see the other opposing force, who's mayors, bringing all the food and all the cargo and everything to everyone on Earth, still trying to hold up and fight the battle against the dark elves. And so then right in that microcosm alone, you have this war locked in with two different diametrically opposed state of consciousness. Obviously, one in promotion of death and the discovery of what happens beyond that by any means. And one who is pro-life and the sustaining of life and not so much as the focus on death and immortality. You see what I mean? So this is, you know, what we have going on, but you see that everyone functions as a mother and a father to something. Because a lot of times you may be back there like, well, I don't have no kids. All of these are your kids. We talked about this before, like all these children out here, that's one. So it's just all about what you're tapped into and what you can really feel. And then the second thing is you have the ideas. You have all of the developments. All these other things that are not complete also become your children to rear up properly, even from stages of their deformity. So I don't think at all that very advanced human beings have an inkling of fear against any of these so-called deformed or out of phi creatures running around the nether worlds. So if anything, it seemed to me that their entire job was to rear those beings up by showing them a greater level of perfection, because there is a hardwired instinct within every single organism. And that hardwired instinct says, if you see something better, and it's available to you, and you feel like it's available to you, go for it. And so that's the bridge. That feeling like it's available to you is the bridge. If we can become, as teachers, individuals that make people, or not make, the person gets to do it, can get people to feel like this transformation is for them. This transformation is something able to be accomplished. And the reason why they should know anyway, because sometimes in sleep you don't know this, but it's all the formula. And it's also very connected to how a plant grows. Because a plant grows in this dank, stank soil that has all these minerals and bacteria and all kind of different things, because that's what it needs to cultivate. So when we turn back around and we say, well, we're in this matrix, which is synonymous with a womb, why can't we see that the dank and stank would in fact be involved in the part of our emancipation and growth into the next stage of our consciousness as trees, you know what I mean, rather than seeds? So that's what I'm looking at now. These are the facts that I'm forced to say to myself. Can you not see the forest for the trees? Here we go. 646, you're on wholeness. Okay, area code 646, you waited so long.
I did. I really wanted to get on today. Wholeness, how are you?
Wholeness, how you doing?
I'm well. I have two questions for you, so I'm going to try to be very specific. I've been following you for a while, so I feel that you'll kind of pick up and know where I am. So first thing is, when I was 16, on the day I found out that I was pregnant, it was, of course, I didn't want to get pregnant, whatever, but it was, the happiest day. I say I've never experienced any joy like that. That night, I usually would read through the night, but that night I, hit the bed early. I turned off the light. I got the sense of a snake slithering up onto the top bunk bed. And then I felt the snake slither through my body, starting from the soles of my feet up my head. I jump off the bed, right, because I felt the coldness of the snake on my body, felt everything on me. I can even smell it, you know, the mist, everything. I jump off the bed, all right, and I'm from New York City, so I grab the bat nearby, and I'm hitting my bed, you know, I turn on the light. I spent about an hour and a half looking for this snake everywhere because I was sure that there was a snake on my bed. You know, I've been meditating for a long time. I was over someone that, you know, I was doing readings when I was like 4 years old. So, you know, I came in and I still was able to retain a lot of my stuff from when I came in, but I can never figure out what that experience was. And when I was reading your book, when I, you know, you do such a great job at talking about, you know, serpents and all these things, it just kind of like this light came on. It's like, maybe I should, you know, maybe this is the guy that can kind of help me figure out what that experience was. So, I mean, obviously, you know, I don't know that you'll know exactly what that was, but maybe have an idea of, I don't get what that would be because I've never had, you know, even in my work, I've never had experience with those type of entities, or I think anyway.
Okay, for sure. I can definitely give you some clarity on that. And let me just make sure I keep an eye on this chat box because I don't have another recording running. So for some reason we cut off, I'm sure someone will say, hey, I can't hear. And by the way, if for some reason you guys can't hear over there, make sure you type it in the chat box. Don't just sit there expecting it to come back on. But let me explain this. Energy moves in waves, and this is why those energies became synonymous with snakes, okay? Because if you've ever held a snake before, when especially if a snake is actually upset, you can get an idea, even from a baby snake, exactly how much energy these snakes really have. Like, and remember, I didn't create the snake. So some people are like, oh, are you saying the snakes are good? You know, this is crazy. I always say, I have a disclaimer about talking about these serpents. To say all the serpents are evil is just as silly as saying all the humans are good. But let's realize exactly what we're dealing with serpentine energies, because they do move in that coil-like motion or that curving type motion, but they move from south to north, okay? And this is also synonymous with Kundalini, where Kundalini moves up the body. So I can't specifically tell you what the energy was because I just wasn't there. But what I can tell you is what I was already led to as far as information, and I was looking for a point when this information was actually going to come out. And this information is about what we have actually witnessed on our planet from the south to the north and what that looks like on a spiritual level. And what happened is that the areas of Angkor Wat, which are in the deeper recesses of the south, especially from a geographical level, were basically many of the fertilization points or the first portals in which the entities or the energies that are now residing on this planet in different bodies came out of. Okay, and these beings became known as Nagas, Nethers, Devas, etc. Very highly energetic forms that moved in waves and can waft you with energy, meaning that the energy coming off of some of these beings was so strong it would put a person into somewhat of an illusion. They would swoon. And it was even known in the old days that people that appeared to be in that type of stage, which later on became drugs, was known to be somehow being affected or possessed by one of these energies, okay? And then obviously this also accompanied being able to tell the future, because anytime you get a higher level of energetic upheaval, generally one of the first abilities besides the slight electricity or magnetic force coming from the hand is the ability to project out into that particular plane or even beyond it to see what may take place next, okay? But the interesting thing is that there happened to be something of a deluge or inundation within that area where it basically vomited up or gave up all of its inhabitants. So then you saw all the people from the south. Now remember, this is really integral to the Naga. Moving from the south to the north, meaning those same people that are now in Cambodia and in Angkor Wat, etc., now are also the same people that became Native Americans. So they were already there in the north before Columbus got there, right? So here's the mystery. The mystery is that when the snake moves from the bottom, once if it can make it to the top, it becomes a bird. Because if you look at any of the real Ouroboros symbols, that the bottom one is a snake or known as worm, and then the top one is actually some type of winged dragon. Likewise, in genus, because it's also in there, because I have to prove that is true, a snake eventually evolves into a bird. Scales become feathers. And this, you can go to the Wikipedia, BBC, or whatever, and find that information out. So this is why it becomes integral for us to see the transformation, but also to understand many of the serpentine energies that are still moving about, especially the southern hemisphere, still causing chaos. Because we're not going to say all of the places in the southern hemisphere are out of control, but you can denote that places that are further lower in the southern hemisphere, like even Africa at this point, have a lot of chaos and turmoil going on. And this, and from those who are down there that have third eyes and spiritual eyes, they say it's because the serpents are overrunning the place. They have no instructors. And this was also noted about Peru, because Mount Meru moved to Peru, and then a couple of gentlemen that were master meditators went down there, and they came back to Costa Rica, and they said, Seven, you wouldn't even believe it. There was serpents everywhere. We never experienced anything like that before. So then when you go deeper into the teachings, you find that the earth has these openings, just as sure as we have openings, right? I got my mouth, there's the anus, etc. There's openings. So in the earth's south pole, in its opening, what comes forth from there, the vapor or the air, which is very dank, is actually the energetic force of what we know as the serpent. Now, let me show you how deep this connects, because as above, so below, even in your body, when your southern pole, which is actually your anus, when what comes out of there, in what form does it look like? It is a tube and it is dank, okay? So this is why when they got to a certain stage of consciousness, they already knew, we got to get to the north, we got to get to the north. So they basically started migrating towards the north because they were trying to reach the crown point, aka the white rabbit, that's what the Germans called it, but they were trying to reach the northernmost point of the planet, because they believed that also too there was an opening. But instead of dealing with the malevolence of the southern hemisphere, they would be dealing with the benevolence. And from my from reports that people have brought to me personally, they say in fact that that is true. That on the northern part, you get to the next stage of the consciousness, which is more of a larger human being. Now, this is how you'll know that this is true. We don't come from the outside in. We come from the inside out. And you'll see that with how you're born. You come from your inside of your mother out, right? So the first beings that arrived here on this planet, I can't give them the term original beings. This is really going to upset the melanin dominated. But the original beings, there was no quote-unquote original being. We need to kill that whole idea. And the reason is because what we do is we leave from one planet, even if it's Mars, and then we birth from the inside of this planet. We stay inside the planet for a while. This is what you see going on in Ta Mary, which is the Nile Valley right there. There's a womb inside of the earth, okay? And then, so we will remain there from an energetic level until we were birthed from that particular canal, okay? And then where we would be coming from, though, is from another world that we had maxed out until we went into another stage of incubation. Meaning when you get in a world and you learn everything, because remember, this is a university, and remember, learning everything doesn't mean that you're going to get this big giant book and start reading about all the elements in the planet. It means that you master one system. You just become the master, the true master of one thing. All of it will collapse because you'll see everything works the same way. And then what happens then is the implosion, and then you come back out into another sphere that is more graduated. So just understand that it depends on where you are. There's a lot of things that people can bring around. There's a different level of, there's a different level to this called consecration. And what consecration is that when someone can consecrate an area that actually becomes a harmonic portal for lower developed entities, okay? And because what this is about is you first get a witness of this in the higher worlds within the ritualistic traditions that go with consecrating things like Buddha statues, which the Catholics stole and later on just acted out a half-hearted tradition of consecrating their churches and temples, okay? So I'm sure if you've been to church before, you've heard, if you've heard of consecration before, this is when someone is specifically elected to come in and to like charge the place. And now if you go to the Eastern tradition, they'll tell you that they don't, that the statues that are in those temples have energy fields around them. But if they don't, and because it's a vivid thing, it's because it has not been consecrated. And then they have to call someone in and they have to come and consecrate. Now, what this is all about is that this is about that people, there's many people, especially that are calibrated for this, but there are many individuals who do this unknowingly, are so energetic that they actually create these spaces. And of course, those spaces highly depend on what kind of energies they're playing host to, if any kind of energies at all. So if you get one of these individuals in your area or circumference, and you happen to enter into the region where the dimensions are much closer together, this is around 3 or 4 in the morning, because at 3 or 4 in the morning, that's why day becomes night, is because, night becomes day, or it depends on what perspective you're on, but that's how day becomes night or night becomes day, is at a certain point, right? And this is because the dimensions are closest together. So at that point and at that moment, which lasts for about 15, 20 minutes, you can literally, like some people say they received like taps or something was there, or, you know, these kind of phenomena are a lot more easier to witness. And then obviously when you get up, right away, it's not going to be there because you've already shifted frequency, but you're definitely not going to see it in the reality unless you have a really good third sight as to where it went. And so this is just about different areas. And this is why, and we talk about astral hygiene. This is literally having your little kit together. You know, maybe you got some sage, maybe you got some San Paolo, maybe you have some, just any high frequency oils. And when you have to go somewhere, and some of it's going to be a different way of life, but I think it's going to catch on. But realistically, I tell you got to think about this. Like when you go into, like a woman has a hole, man has a smaller one, but a woman has, we all have holes, but woman has her womb. So if she goes and she sits down on this chair that thousands of people have sat on, this old dirty chair, it's not far off for there to be some kind of energetic contamination there. But a simple spray in the hand, like, and you just sit down, it may seem a little odd to everyone else, but then they'd be like, what are you doing? What did you do that for? It's like, did you know that some of these places energetically contaminated? Well, what do you mean? Well, it's that simple. It's simple. Like basically when people carry very dank energy and then they leave it there with the DNA and all of that, it affects you. And this, if you just watch this, like, and obviously you don't want to become a fanatic about it, but if you watch this, you'll start seeing your own self-substantiation, because this means you're at least watching. It doesn't even matter if it works or not. I personally know that it works, but the reality is that even to use silver, silver also is very effective for disinfecting things, and it has no effect. Like, you're not going to be spraying bleach or spraying a smell that someone may be like, oh, I don't like the way that smells, and you end up getting in some drama for that. Just silver, and hit the silver, and then just do your thing. Just being more conscious again of the kind of energies and knowing that they're there, because that's the biggest thing, I think, with all of this stuff, is that sometimes this has a tendency for people to be like watching like some entertainment or something like that. After the thing shuts off, they're like, they don't actually apply it to their life or think that it goes with their life. Like lady I was speaking to earlier is a very, very good example, because now she already probably knew all that kind of stuff was going on energetically. I just explained it in a different way. But from her seeing the results so many times, like falling down the ladder, coming down the ladder so many times, then it's like, okay, now I see that this, it's like a separate confirmation in yourself, because you're like, you know what? Okay, that's my last time trying to convince myself that I really do need to be more concerned about the different kind of individuals that I yoke myself with. Before you can start going with the flow, because everyone likes to use that comment like, well, I'm going to go with the flow of things. And then somebody comes around and they're like, well, if the universe didn't want me to be around them, then they wouldn't be here. Oh my goodness, don't start that. The universe doesn't want,
that's dangerous.
Yeah, let's get it clear. Like the universe is on something else. So this means that we are personally responsible for mandamus, which is to enforce within ourselves even things that are not written. So that's what I'll give you on that.